That song is jamming. I come up to that song every day. Y'all can play that when I go up to bat or something. I'll come down. Oh, sorry. All right. Welcome to Revolution Church. Good morning. Good morning. Thank you. Man, I'm so honored to be up in front of you guys again. I want to thank Richard and Holly for entrusting me with the word that the Lord has this morning. If you don't know who I am, my name's AJ. I'm a student pastor here at Revolution Church. My wife and I have been here for about 2.5 months now. When I say Heather and I have been doing stuff with the students, I really do mean that. Like I might have the title of student pastor, but that woman works her tail off for those students. And it would be wrong for me. Yeah, exactly. It would be wrong for me to take all of that credit, because Heather is loving on your kids. She is pouring her heart out into these students. And it's an amazing thing to see her step into her her calling as well. And so, yeah, y'all lift her up and love on her too. And let me tell y'all something. We love y'all's students. We love y'all's kids. Like, Heather and I have been overwhelmed almost with how quickly, like, overwhelmed with how quickly we've been just attached and loved on y'all's students. And so, just excited to continue to do that. It wants to play that song again, I guess. But here's the deal. When Heather and I first got here 2.5 months ago, crackle, crackle, snap, crackle, pop, Rice Krispies. When we first got here, we didn't necessarily feel like this was our church, right? We didn't feel like this was our place. And we certainly didn't feel like the students were our students, right? And that's part of moving somewhere. Like, you're not going to immediately feel like it's your place. You're not going to immediately feel like your home, right? Speaking of home, we just so happened to be in the middle of a series called Home Sweet Home, as you saw in that video with the awesome soundtrack made by Miss Sally Peavy. See what I did there, transition? Where Richard is wanting to lay the groundwork of what it looks like to be a part of the kingdom of God, and how our church specifically, he wants to function as a part of that kingdom of God. And last week, Richard talked about how all of us have a place at the table. How Mephibosheth, say that 5 times fast. No, wait, don't. You might say something you regret later, because that's a tongue twister and a half, and it just wants you to say something bad. But Mephibosheth, he didn't deserve a spot at David's table, right? He was crippled, he was bruised, he was banged up, he was imperfect. But because of David's loyalty to Jonathan, because Mephibosheth was a part of Jonathan's family, right? Jonathan's value in David's heart in turn gave Mephibosheth, in turn gave him value. And Richard pointed out how that's exactly what God has for us. We have no value. We are crippled. We are bruised. We are imperfect. We are banged up. We have a lot of sins and mistakes and past and struggles that we bring to the table. But because if we have stepped into a relationship with Jesus, that God sees us through the lens of Jesus and who he is, that because Jesus has value, then we have value, not because of anything we've done. And that's beautiful. Man, I'm getting fired up. I'm getting chills just re-preaching what Richard preached last week, because it was fire, right? Our pain does not define us. Our past does not disqualify us. Our performance does not deliver us. And his promise does not disown us. Woo! Man, that's good stuff. And that's just what Richard said last week. But I had to talk about that for a second to make sure we know that we are all welcome at his table. We are all welcome in the body of Christ. We are all welcome in this place, so we can take it a step further this morning. And I think to an extent that hit home, right? Like, I think a lot of people left feeling like, you know what? I do feel at home with Jesus. I do feel like he loves me. I do feel like he has welcomed me at his table. Matter of fact, I think I feel maybe at home here. Maybe not. I hope so. But as we were leaving last Sunday, I heard a lot of people say, you know what that reminds me of? You know who that reminds me of? That hospitality? That reminds me of D. Davis. Man, When you walk into Dee Davis' house, that woman welcomes people into her home, right? You feel like you belong there. The Kellys and the Hendricks have made Heather and I really feel welcome in their home. You know who does that? You know who's hospitable? Sandra Collis, Shelly Frady. I can shout out people all day. Pat's everybody's mama, right? And everybody's Beth Faulkner's sweet baby. That's two things we know as a part of this body right here. The first day, we didn't even live here yet. Heather and I came up to visit, and Beth Faulkner came up and she said, sweet baby. She said, I know y'all are far away from home, but while y'all are here, we're gonna be y'all's mamas, okay? So y'all just let us know what y'all need. Give it up for Beth Faulkner. Is she in here? I don't know if she's volunteering in kids. But sweet baby. Sweet baby Ray's. Yep, anyway, I'm all over the place here. But we can feel at home when there are hosts, right? And I think that's a great image to have of how God feels towards us. But what I want us to do this morning is think of how welcoming those people are. Think of how welcoming they are to have you as a part of your home. And there's a lot of other people that I didn't say your names that are welcoming as well. But think about the person that you feel welcome at their place and know that that's who Jesus is. That Jesus welcomes us into his house, to God's house. Everyone's welcome here, right? Richard is our pastor. He sets the precedent that anybody with any baggage can walk into this place and not feel out of place because, honestly, you fit in. We all got some baggage, right? We all got some. We all got a past. We all got a history. We all got stuff that we wish we didn't do, that God had to forgive us for. But I want us to take that a step further. So we not just feel welcome in this place, but we take ownership in this place. You feel welcome here. That's great. Now I need you to be a part of making others feel welcome. When Heather and I first started with the students, I mentioned that before, but when we first started, for the first couple weeks, we kind of just sat in the background. We kind of just were a little bit of a part of it, and we let Brad speak. Holly spoke one week. Man, I guess when Holly spoke, it must have been fire because we got all kinds of stuff happening back here. Maybe I should get a handheld mic, possibly. But somebody agrees, I think. All right. Anyways, we'll just... Maybe it's just sound effects. Are you guys doing that back there on purpose with sound effects, just making it sound more cool? I'm just playing. But when Heather and I first started with the students, we let Brad speak, amen and hallelujah. Thank you, Brian. Brian's the man. Brian's the man. Down the street. All right. 1 second, let me get rid of this. Y'all clap for me or something. All right, there we go. Yes, thank you, Brittany. All right, so, like I was saying, when Heather and I first started with the students, we kind of sat back for a minute, right? And we let Brad and Holly speak, and now we're getting back on track. But now, as we began to understand, okay, this is where these students are, this is what these students need, then we stepped into that position of authority. We stepped into that position of leadership and ownership in that student ministry because we felt welcome, and then we stepped up. Now, granted, in that situation, we kind of had to. Y'all probably would wonder why Richard hired a youth pastor and his wife who don't really do anything. They just kind of let everybody else do everything. So it's kind of a little bit of a different analogy. But the same applies to each of us. You feel welcome here. Awesome. We want you to. We want this to be a place where everybody feels like they can come. But now let's take part in making others feel at home. If this is your first time here, you are so welcome. And I hope you do feel very welcome in this place. I hope you do. I hope people shook your hand. I hope people took the time to meet you. If they didn't, I'm sorry. I apologize. That's what we're intending to do. But please don't take that out on that one person who didn't shake your hand. Don't take out on Jesus, on the perfect God that we serve. Don't take out on him what his imperfect people failed to do. Please. Because sometimes we imperfectly display what our perfect Creator is doing. And our perfect Creator says, everyone is welcome. He says, come to me, you who are weary and burdened. And he doesn't say, come to me, you, and you who are weary and burdened. And we're going to leave this side of the room out of it, okay? But I hope you do feel welcome in this place. And I hope you do feel like you can make this your home. But if you've been coming here for a while, if you've been here for a little bit, you've been coming for some months, you've been coming for some years, you've been coming for some weeks, you need to transition your thoughts from I'm welcome in this place to this is our place. You see the difference there? Holly Myers may be welcoming to every single person who comes into her house, right? She may welcome every single person, but when Rachel and Rebecca come home, she may be just as welcoming, but when they come home, they've got something to do, okay? Because they live there, whether they chose to or not. And in this place, we chose to be here. We choose to come here every Sunday. And let me tell you something. This place is just as much yours as it is anybody else's. This church is not Richard's. Richard's our leader. Richard's our shepherd. This church is God's. It's God's. And we're all his children. And if we're all his children, just as Rachel and Rebecca are Holly and Richard's children, it's not just that we're welcome, but there's something expected of us. We have to take that a step further. Open up your Bibles to Galatians 6, verse 1. We're going to be in 6, verse 1 through 10. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to read through the whole thing. We'll have it up on the screens. If you don't have your Bibles, you can use your YouVersion. That don't offend me. But what we're going to do is I'm going to read all the way through. And this scripture is really filled to the brim with meat. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read it all the way through, like I said. Then I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to chop up a little bit of that meat piece by piece. And just like some Texas brisket, my hope and prayer is that that meat's going to fall right off the bone and ready for us to eat up. Is anybody hungry? Because I am. Come on, somebody. Yeah, hand clap for some food, some brisket. Okay, Galatians 6, verse 1 through 10. I can't figure it out over here. I'm just going to read it off my iPad if that's all right with everybody. Is that all right? All right, 6 verse 1. Brothers and sisters, if anyone is caught up in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he is something when he's nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one test his own work, and then his reason to boast will be in himself alone and not in his neighbor. For each will have to bear his own load. Let the one who is taught the word share all good things with the one who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. And let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we don't give up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are in the household of faith. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you so much for your word. We thank you so much that we come to a church, Lord, that we give everything, that with everything we shout for your praise, with everything we shout for your glory. And so, Lord, I pray that today in this place, that the people who don't feel like they can give everything, who don't feel like they have a place entirely in this place, Lord, that you would break that down, that you would take that apart. God, that you would take whatever it is that's keeping them from going all in with you, from not just feeling home sweet home in this place, but being a part of what makes this place home sweet home for others. God, that you would break that down, that you would completely disintegrate that. And then in the name of Jesus, I pray that you would break down barriers, that you would break off chains, that you would break off every kind of thing that's withholding us in this place from experiencing all of who you are, Jesus. And as we read your scripture, Lord, I pray that you would open our eyes. Lord, that I would not be in your way, that you would use me as your vessel, everything you want to say today would be said, and that I would get out of the way. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Man, I can't stop thinking about brisket now. Y'all got this Texas boy hungry. All right, Galatians 6, verse 1. says again, brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. So right off the bat in this passage of scripture, Paul acknowledges to the people of Galatia that there's a possibility for people to get caught up in transgression. And this isn't in reference to those who don't know Jesus. Obviously, in other passages of scripture, we know that God's grace is sufficient. We know that he forgives all things. We know that he is capable. We know that he isn't afraid of our junk, that he is willing to forgive us for everything, that he's welcomed us in this place, right? But in this context, Paul doesn't disconnect the terms brothers from the term transgressions, okay? In fact, your translation might say overtaken by trespasses. And when you hear the word overtaken or getting caught up, there's almost this sense of unwittingly, unknowingly, unintentionally getting caught up in that sin. But it doesn't take away from the gravity of the mistake, but it's referencing people who know Jesus who get caught up in their transgressions, okay? But all of that aside, what I want us to pay attention to is the charge that Paul gives us to those not caught up in sin, to those who see those caught up in sin. He says that we are supposed to seek their restoration, to not condemn them, not shun them, not make sure they feel unwelcome, as a lot of churches are in the habit of doing, or not take the other extreme of that and pretend like nothing's happening. Pretend like you're not going to see what they've done. Pretend like you don't want any part of it. Pretend like you don't think that they're welcome. Pretend like you're not in a place that could ever commit that sin that they did. But rather, we want to seek to restore them. And we don't just want to make things right. We don't just want to look to fix things. But to seek to restore them with a spirit of gentleness is what it says. A spirit of gentleness. Why? Because we know that we are just as privy to sin and just as weak as they are. A spirit of gentleness is the posture of putting others above yourself and not forgetting that you're also flawed and in need of forgiveness. Therefore, my view of this person's need for Jesus is seen through the lens of my own view of my own need for that same Savior, that same forgiver, that same comforter, that same Prince of Peace, that same friend. But our common posture is not the spirit of gentleness, but rather a spirit of gossip or a spirit of self-righteousness. Man, I can't believe how far off the path they are, bless their heart. Or, I just can't imagine. I would never do that. And just because you would never do such and such that so-and-so did does not mean that you need any less forgiveness than they do, that you need any less grace, any less mercy than they do. And that's what it means to respond out of a spirit of gentleness. Our duty as a church, our duty as sisters and brothers in Christ is to bear the burden that is weighing down on those around us and shoulder it with them. Let me do this real quick. Shoulder it with them. This remind you of anything? Shouldering that weight? Because John 13:34 says, a new command I give to you, to love one another just as I have loved you. You are also to love one another. By this, people will know you are my disciples if you love one another. How did Jesus love us? How did Jesus love us? He bore our burden. He took it all the way to the cross that he didn't deserve, the cross that we did deserve, the death that we did deserve, the eternal damnation that we did deserve. He threw that in the trash because he loved us. So how do we love the way Jesus loved us? We seek to bear the burdens of others. We seek to help them carry the weight that God never intended for them to carry by themselves. Back to Galatians 6, verse 3. It says, for anyone who thinks he's something, when he is nothing, he deceives himself. So what's going to keep us from bearing one another's burdens or allowing others to help us? Pride. Or self-pity. Or some kind of self-focus that's so focused on who I am and what I need. Pride isn't always saying that I'm better than everybody else, but it is always saying that I'm more important than everybody else. But in contrast, biblical humility tells us, I'm nothing, but you are something. Let me care about your needs. Paul reiterates this concept in Philippians 2, verse 3 through 4. It says, it'll be up on the screens. It says, do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you not look only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. In order to truly be a part of this church body and a part of the body of Christ, our perspective has to change from what do you have for me to what can I give to you? We have to look at what we can give other people. We have to see their needs, their burdens, and see how we can help carry that. Are there any parts of your life right now that need that perspective swap? I know I do. I'll confess right now. And maybe a lot of y'all have this exact same thing, but in my marriage with Heather, if in our marriages, listen, because this is good, if in our marriages our perspective changed from what she hasn't done for me to what can I do for her, that's a game changer. If it changes from what more can I, if it changes to what more can I do to make your life easier, to what more can you do to make mine easier, it's a game changer. What can I do to make you feel loved? What can I do to give you more rest? And some of y'all hold your thought pattern because some of y'all just immediately thought, exactly, if he thought that way, exactly, if he thought that way, we'd have a lot better marriage. Exactly, if she thought that way, then maybe someday I would get a break because she don't know that I'm working all day. I'm working 8 to 5 every day. I come home and she don't want to whatever from me. And she want to ask me to do something for the kids. She's been with the kids all day. Maybe. Maybe she's been working a job all day too. And I'm not just trying to hammer this at the guys because I know the ladies struggle with this too, but I know that there are some men in this place that we have some self-righteous pride that needs to be broken. We have some entitlement that needs to be broken. And yes, we are the leader of our household. Yes, our family is supposed to submit to us. But if we are not submitting to Jesus, if we are not submitting to our Father, we have no right to ask them to follow us. If you stop thinking about how convicting this should be for somebody else, you'll start realizing how convicting it is for you. Galatians 6, verse 4, we're moving on. It says, but let each one test his own work, and then his reason to boast will be in himself alone and not in his neighbor. And that's not saying, real quick, that's not saying that you're supposed to boast in yourself. That's saying that you no longer need the approval. You no longer need the validation of others because you're so content in the Lord and who he is in you. That's not saying it's giving you the right to boast right there. I didn't have that planned out, but let me just continue. For each, in verse 5, it says, for each will have to bear his own load. You might say, wait a second, there's a contrast here, AJ. Hold up. You just said that we are supposed to bear one another's burdens, and now this is saying that each one is supposed to bear his own load. What's happening right now? Which is it? Well, I'm going to tell you, calm down. You can get your brisket. Yeah. For those of you who didn't catch that, in verse 2, it says bear one another's burdens, but in verse 5, it says each will have to bear his own load. And the word used for burdens in verse 2 is a heavy burden, a heavy weight, not meant to be carried alone. The word used here for load is meant more like a lightweight, like a backpack, which I think is so cool. When I read that, I gotten a lot of this from a commentary that David Guzik did on blueletterbible.com. Y'all should check that out because it breaks stuff apart. But it says that the load is something like a backpack, which I think, like I said, is so cool. Because a few weeks ago, if you weren't here, Holly Myers brought her backpack on stage. She brought her backpack on stage. And our backpack is the things we carry, the choices we've made, the things to which God is going to hold us accountable. But what we do, like Holly said, is we put these labels that are more like bricks in our backpack, and it gets heavy. It gets heavier. Our sin, our past, who we feel like the Lord sees us as, who we feel like we self-identify as, who we feel like other people think we are. And what we as the body are supposed to do is we're supposed to call out the lies that the people around us are believing. And as we just read in verse 1 and 2, we as the body are supposed to help carry those burdens that have overtaken our brothers and sisters. And ultimately, as we grow in the Lord and grow in our knowledge of Him and in community, we will realize that a lot of that burden we were never supposed to carry in the first place. We'll continue in verse 6. It says, let the one who is taught the word share all good things with the one who teaches. Let me read that one more time. Let the one who is taught the word share all good things with the one who teaches. Now, this passage is one of the hardest things for a pastor to ever read. And I'm so honestly, I'm excited that I got to read it. I didn't realize it was there when I first picked the scripture. I missed this verse, but I'm excited about it because here's the deal. It's saying that us, and I'm including me in that us as the congregation, us are those who are taught. Because it's saying, us are those who are taught, that we're supposed to share all good things with the one who teaches. Who's the one who teaches us? Richard. Richard's the one who teaches us. Richard is the one who God has chosen, appointed as the leader of this church. And let me break it down for you this way. We're blessed, guys. We are blessed with an amazing pastor. A pastor who I know and I believe will lead this church because I see the way he leads his family. A pastor who loves each and every one of us at Revolution Church, who loves this city, who loves the people and talks to the people that nobody else wants to love or talk to. That's who our pastor is. He loves the people in this building. He loves the people outside of it. Richard is one of the most godly, forgiving, preserving, loving. Let me read this so that I can get it all out because I want to make sure y'all don't miss a part of Richard's character because I believe in this man. He's the most godly, forgiving, preserving, loving, generous man of God I know. So when I read that I'm supposed to share all good things with him, I almost feel guilty for how much he's already given to me and to us. The resources he's already invested above and beyond what I could ever give him into his family, into this church. And let me tell you something I know. Let me tell you something that God is going to do. God is going to honor the sacrifice, the generosity, and the love that Richard has poured out on this body. The ways that he's blessed others. The ways he's reached out to help carry the burdens of others, of me. You know how I know that? Because of this next verse we're about to read. It says, do not be deceived. Verse 7, God is not mocked, for whatever one sows, that he will also reap. But just because God is going to honor the things that Richard has done for us, the things he is doing, the things he will do, if by the grace and the glory of God, he continues to be faithful, he continues to remain faithful to his calling, to his people, to his family. Just because God is going to bless him does not mean we're excluded from doing so now. It's not just talking about money. It is talking about money. It is talking about blessing him financially and with temporal resources. But it's also talking about your time, your energy, your resources, pouring out what you're now able to pour out because of what Richard has poured into us. And not just sitting back and being lazy because, well, Richard has always done this much. And he'll be fine. Or maybe, never mind. Whatever the excuse is in your mind keeping you from being generous, eradicate it. Because in the same way that Jesus has displayed and championed generosity by his dying on the cross, by his bearing our burdens for us, Richard has followed suit and done the exact same. And it is our duty as members of this body, as those being taught, to give back to the man who God has entrusted to lead and teach us. I'm not saying walk up to him and hand him $100. I'm not saying maybe that's what you feel called to do. I'm not saying give more in your tithe. I don't care about your tithe. I do. God does. He does. And that is part of what this is talking about. But what I'm saying is when you look at Richard's life, when you look at the things he's doing, how can we not? With how much he is pouring his blood and sweat into this church, how can we not give back to him? Richard didn't ask me to do that. He didn't ask me to brag on him. He didn't put me up here on Sunday so I could give some kind of like, make sure you support the pastor message. That's not what I'm here for. He asked me to come preach the word, and one of the things that I feel like is the good word to preach to y'all is how well our pastor loves us and how well he examples Jesus in the way he loves us and pours into us and blesses us and everything else. Yes, we can hand clap for Richard. We'll continue in verse 8. It says, for the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. And that's referencing what Paul had just written in Galatians 5. How the works of the flesh are anger, envy, drunkenness, idolatry, and the long list that you see there if you flip back and read it. And the works or fruit of the Spirit are what? Love, joy, peace, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law, right? When you sow kindness, when you sow peace, when you sow love into those around you, you will reap eternal life. Eternal joy, eternal peace, eternal communion with our holy God. Not because of the works that you're doing, because of the work that Jesus has already done in you for those of us who follow him, but what we're doing is out of that abundance of our heart, out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. So if Jesus has done things in your life, those things should overflow to other people. And when you sow into those things, you will reap all those things. You know how I know that? Because of verse 9, it says, let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. Your translation might say, do not lose heart. And in the ancient world, this phrase, do not lose heart, was something they used when a woman was in labor before she had given birth. There's this sense of there is so much pain. And I've never been in labor. But for those of you who have, bless you. Love y'all. Thank y'all mamas. Appreciate y'all for loving us sweet babies. But the phrase do not lose heart is this reference of there's so much pain, so much work, but that work is still unfinished and unrewarded. And it's easy to lose heart when we feel that way. But let me tell you something. God is not a liar. It's against his character to lie to us. And though it may take a long time for that reaping to happen, it will. It may not be until we're in heaven with him, but God sees the way that we love his children. If someone gives you a gift, it means something, right? It means something. Thank you, especially if your love language maybe is receiving gifts. But when somebody loves on the people that we love, it means so much more. When someone loves on your kids, right? It means something. When someone took the time to come to your little kid's birthday party, when someone took the time to take your child aside and just speak truth into them, it means something. When y'all love on Heather, man, it means something to me, y'all. It does. Like, you can love, you can encourage me, and my love language is encouragement, and you can do all that for me, but the way you will encourage me the most is if you seek to know Heather, if you seek to know her, if you seek to understand how she feels valued, and you seek to make her feel valued in that way. That means the world to me. But who am I? I'm just a dude. I'm just a guy. I'm just an imperfect human on this planet. But we serve a perfect God. And if we know how to give gifts, though we are imperfect, how much more will all perfect God know how to give gifts to his children, especially when we seek to bear the burdens, especially when we seek to love on, especially when we seek to find ways to bring joy to his children. It means eternally more when you offer things to other people that we love than it maybe does when you offer things to me. In verse 10, it says, "So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith." And there it is, household. The household of faith. We have the opportunity to do good to everyone, and especially those in the household of faith. What's the household of faith? The church. So, of course, we're supposed to be kind to everyone, and I think our church does a really good job of doing that. There's not many churches on the planet that have a ministry like GLOW, y'all. That's unheard of in a lot of places. I've told y'all this before, but one of Heather's cousins that doesn't even know Jesus is sending money for GLOW because she can't believe that a church is doing something like that. She can't believe that we're loving on the people who need to be loved on, because she's seen churches want nothing to do with that. She's walked into churches where they don't want the dirty people. But I tell you what, you come in here dirty and I'm going to be excited. You come in here messed up and I'll be excited. You come in here broken and we're going to be hand clapping because we want to be a place where people feel welcome. We want to be a place where anybody has a seat at the table, where you can come in here crippled. You can come in here messed up. You can come in here having nothing in your mind to offer. But we know that Jesus, we serve a God who has everything to offer you. And so therefore, it would be remiss of us. It would be against God's character for us. It would be against us as representers of him to not welcome anybody into this place. But you guys are so generous to people that you've never even met. But where we as a church are beginning to grow, but could probably use a lot of work, is in the context of lifting each other up. Guys, this is the household of faith. The people around you aren't just a part of the greater household of faith, the greater body of Christ, but a part of this household, this specific home. They have been called specifically to this church, under this church's leadership, for this time, just as you have. And we must look for ways to lift and build each other up. We must look for ways to shoulder one another's burdens. We must not be afraid of confrontation, of uncomfortable conversations that are based in love and based out of a desire to see our brother and sisters grow in Jesus. Not out of some kind of holier than thou, I understand things better than you do mentality, but out of grace, out of love, out of joy, and with gentleness, because we know that we need just as much grace as the people beside us. And guys and ladies, if we want to see our church grow, we have to continue to allow ourselves to grow. We must submit ourselves to a higher calling. We must allow ourselves to continue to be molded. Low battery. And we must seek for ways to continue to die to our selfishness, to die to our pride, and look to help carry the burdens of others. I love you guys. Our staff loves you guys. And let me tell you something. Out of that love, there's some men in this house that need to step it up. We as men need to get the heck over ourselves. We need to stop making excuses. Guys, getting back to Richard, he works 40-hour weeks in Charlotte every week. And he's still at Life Group every week. He's still at every single Wednesday night thing we have going on. He's still at every single Monday night staff meeting. He's not here today because he got in the wreck. He's doing all right. But he had a pretty severe concussion. He needed to stay home today. He works all day on Saturday so he can have something to preach for us on Sunday, because he ain't got time the rest of the week because of all the things he's doing. And here's the deal. He'll be the first to tell you that his life isn't perfect. He's not. He's far from perfection. But I'll tell you what Richard is doing right. He is looking for ways to shoulder the burdens of others, maybe almost to a fault, because he loves you guys so much. He's looking for ways to love on the people of this church. He's the primary caretaker of his uncle who has dementia, for crying out loud. And guys, the Myers have gone through some crap. Can I say that on church stage? Maybe not. But they've gone through some junk. They've gone through some stuff. Holly shared a few weeks ago how she was just laid off from her job. And now Richard got in this wreck.
So they've got some unexpected expenses with less than expected income. But you know what? You know what I know they know? You know what I know they know? They know that God is still good. They know that God is still faithful. But I bet it's been hard. I bet they've had moments of doubt, certainly of frustration. God, why? Why tonight? Why after Holly got laid off? Why now do we have all these unexpected expenses? Why now am I going through this? Why now, God, when I feel like you're doing so much in our church, why is this the time that this is happening? But sometimes, listen to this, because this is good. Sometimes I keep putting it down and picking it back up because I realize the next part's going to be good. If we let him, God enjoys doing things that we don't think are possible because he wants to remind us that, yeah, with man, things wouldn't be possible. With man, you wouldn't be able to handle all the things going on in your life right now. You could never make it with your own strength. But I tell you what, with me, God says, with me, you can. You can. Maybe you're in a place where you don't feel like you can handle your burden anymore. Maybe you've never even given those burdens to Jesus in the first place. And if that's the case, you can do that this morning. Maybe you've done a lot of researching about who Jesus is. Maybe you've done a lot of building up your knowledge of God, trying to understand who he is. But you've never taken it from here to here. You've never taken that knowledge. You've never taken what you know about God. You've never taken his goodness. You've never taken his joy. You've never taken his hope. You've never taken his peace and said, you know what? I believe that for myself. I need a relationship with this Jesus. I don't need to just know things about him because scripture says that the devil and demons believe in God. They do so and they shudder. So we don't just need to believe in God. We need to profess him as Lord. We need to profess him as Savior. Believe in our heart, confess with our mouth, Jesus is Lord. That's what salvation looks like. And some of y'all today are so busy worrying about your burdens that you got to carry that you don't know that there's a God right beside you, a Jesus right beside you that wants to say, hold up, hold up. Let me take that and nail that to the cross. Let me take that. Let me take that shame. Let me take that guilt. Let me take that pain. Let me take that divorce. Let me take that miscarriage. Let me take that abortion. Let me take that death. Let me take that part of you that you don't feel like is good enough. And let me nail it to the cross, because that's already done. That's already done. God has already paid the ultimate payment for everything that we could ever carry. He's already paid everything that needs to be paid. All he asks of us is to confess with our mouth, believe in our heart that Jesus is Lord and Savior. And he will nail all of that to the cross. It doesn't mean everything's going to be easy. It doesn't mean everything's not going to be hard anymore. It doesn't mean that we're not going to, again, take up those burdens. It doesn't mean that we're not, again, going to fall into, get caught up in our trespasses or our sin. But what it does mean is we enter into the body of Christ. We enter into this community. We enter into a greater body than just what our family can offer us. We enter into something that looks a lot, it looks a lot like a bunch of broken people, because it is. It looks a lot like a bunch of people who look exactly like us. A lot of people who still need forgiveness. A lot of people who still need grace. A lot of people who aren't perfect. A lot of people who still have anger in their heart. A lot of people who still are short with their tongue. A lot of people who have fallen into lust. A lot of people where their family's got a lot of junk going on. We might not even have a father. We might not even have a father for sure that's been there. We might not even have a dad who wants to be a part of our lives, but we have a heavenly father who will take up where our earthly father left off, where he failed, where he didn't show up, where he wasn't there, and he will take all of that. It doesn't matter if you're way down here, if you're kind of here, if you're kind of here, if you feel like you have the best dad in the world, he still did not live up. He still failed you in somehow, but our God, his love never fails. And so if that's you this morning, if you have never taken off the burden, the weight, the shame, the everything, if you've never began a relationship with Jesus, you can do that this morning. It's not too late. It's not too early. You're not too young. You're not too old. Stop carrying that weight you were never meant to carry by yourself. Some of you know Jesus, and you're still carrying that weight. You're not letting others become a part of your life. You're not letting others in. And if we would let go of our pride, if we would let go of our self-pity, maybe, just maybe, we would see that we could benefit from the people around us. And that they could benefit from us. When our focus goes from what can I get to what can I give, it's a game changer. It's a game changer. So if either of those things apply to you, if you know that you've never taken your head knowledge of Jesus and made it heart knowledge, if you've never began a relationship with Him, or if you have a relationship with Him and you've been too busy shouldering all of your burdens, shouldering all of that load that you were never supposed to carry, I encourage you, I implore you, I challenge you to go to the Blue Room and talk to somebody. Because here's the thing, the Blue Room isn't some kind of special place, guys. What the Blue Room is, here it is. What the Blue Room is it's Michael's secret sauce from Space Jam. At the end of the day, it's just water. It's just water. You can get it from anywhere. But what the Blue Room is it is an atmosphere in which that is accepted. So if you feel like you know people who love Jesus and love you, seek them out. I don't care. I don't care if nobody goes into the Blue Room for the rest of the time we're here. If you are seeking out people who know Jesus, who can sharpen you as iron sharpens iron, who can lift you up, who can take that burden off your shoulders, who can love on you, we won't even need a Blue Room anymore, because our congregation will be self-sufficient, because our congregation will be so focused on what Jesus has for them and what Jesus has for the people around them. We will need a specific place to say, hey, here, you can come get prayer here. Here, you can come get whatever it is you need here. But what that room is it's a place where you can come with your burdens. You can come weary and burdened, and the people in there who know Jesus will help shoulder a little bit of that and help give you rest. But you can't enter into that body of Christ type of sharing of burdens until you've entered into a relationship with Christ. The vertical has to start before the horizontal. It has to. Maybe y'all have been confessing stuff to your friends around you for a long time, but you can't figure out, why can't I get past this? Why can't I move on? Why can't I, whatever it is. And maybe it's because you've spent too much time confessing and talking and laying out your junk on the table to others. You forgot that first you need to have a relationship with the Creator. You need to have a relationship with the Father. The Creator of the entire universe desires a relationship with each and every one of us specifically. That's ridiculous. That's crazy. But that's awesome. But we have to enter into that relationship. We have to allow Him to shoulder our burden and take it to the cross and forgive us of our sins before the people around us can help shoulder that weight. In Luke 10:2, and I'll close with this. Y'all can stand up. In Luke 10, verse 2, Jesus tells 72 appointed disciples. Some of y'all are like, 72? I thought there was just 12. Well, here He's talking to 72 of them, and He's sending them out. He told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into His harvest." And that's my prayer for Revolution Church. Let us be people who seek that labor, who seek that harvest, who seek out opportunities to sow into others. Not because we know that we will reap that reward, but because we understand the gravity of our calling and the depth to which our Father loves us. How deep the Father's love for us. How vast beyond all measure. That He would give His only Son and make a wretch His treasure. That's what we are. That's all we are. We're wretches. We're sinful. We're broken. We have nothing to offer at the end of the day. But Jesus has everything to offer. And if we enter into a relationship with him, there's so much that he has for you. There's so much more that he has for you. If you just let go. Let go of what you're holding so tightly, whatever it is, whatever's keeping you. We just sang, with everything, with everything, with everything, we will shout for your praise. With everything, we will shout for your glory. With everything, I give my life to you. But some of y'all are there thinking, with something, with a little bit, I'll give you some, God, but I'm gonna hold on to this little part right here because I don't believe you can forgive that. I'm gonna hold on to this little part right here because my family doesn't look like a normal family, God. I'm gonna hold on to this part like right here because the reality is you might say that you can forgive me, God, but you haven't seen this part of me yet. God knows all things. God sees everything. He sees it all. So since God sees everything, God already knows everything, and he still says he'll forgive us. He still says his love for us. His love is for us. What's keeping you from giving everything? What's keeping you from saying with everything? With everything? With everything? Sometimes it's because you haven't entered a relationship with him, and sometimes it's because you're too busy holding on to everything. But God says, he loves us in spite of our everything.